First best of two of eight this evening, as yes, we do have that much StarCraft to bring you guys. 16 maps of StarCraft 2. It really doesn't get much better than that. Gotta love the OSC system, and very excited for it to come back once again. Do we not have... Oh, we do have stream delay on. I just saw myself walking away on the stream, and I was like, oh my god, there's no stream delay, but it was actually when I went to unplug the webcam rather than opening the window just a few moments ago. Whew. I was going to say, that would have been a disaster having to reset the stream already. Alright, let's do this then. Top right-hand side of the map is going to be that red cross player. It is going to be Neeb from Ting. And down to the bottom left-hand side, our blue Terran player is going to be Beastyqt. Is my bot dead already? Why is my bot dead? Oh, man. Is there everything here where things work? Or where things do work? I don't know why the bot is suddenly broken. The bot has suddenly decided just to stop. I'm going to have to try and fix that during the break, guys. For now, let's focus up on this game. Mine, Santi's Beastyqt bottom left, Ting's Neeb top right, and it's Daybreak to kick us off into what should be a fairly standard game number one for this TVP series. So kicking off into this, we'll have a look to see how things will go. Now, the second map will be Varney Research Station, Beastyqt's map pick here from the map pool. Again, these best of two group stage round robins, it's an interesting one. It's something that's done in a lot of other games, best of twos. And it's something which is been done once in StarCraft 2 before, in SSL Challenger League of season of 2016, season 2 of that. So that's kind of where the format was sort of inspired from. I actually really like the format, because we saw yesterday, it's really cool. It gives a lot of players chances to maybe take a quick game here and there, and it's like a little bit more volatile than usual maybe for group stage. But it's cool. You get to see some interesting games. It really hits kind of the right amount of games as well for a six-player group. Like, it feels the best of threes, and we would have taken, you know, the last yesterday would have taken so long, it would have been crazy. But for the best of twos, it's actually pretty reasonable. It really truly is. It's genuinely quite reasonable. So it was really, really some good stuff, honestly, yesterday, and I'm really just expecting great games once again today. Should be fantastic, so hopefully you guys feel the same. And do let me know what's up, let me know how you're doing, and let me know if you're cheering on anyone in particular in this group. I know that Neeb is obviously going to be quite a favorite, as is Innovation. I really feel the third place slot is going to be up for grabs from a lot of different people, though. I mean, we're talking about the potential of, I mean, anyone, really. Jim Rising, Beastyqt, Guru, and Cyan could all have a good day and could grab that third place slot, or even higher, as we saw yesterday. Semper makes it out of the group in first place, Nurture in second, and Stats in third. Absolutely crazy, as we are going to be seeing. There's Adept just coming out, and this Reaper is just going to be backing away and looking to see what else is going on. Just wants to stay alive for another few minutes in this game, basically. So Reaper comes around to the side, is actually going to be under attack here from the Adept for a few moments. Going to continue to back away now, though, and actually will still be chased and still will go down here in the end. Just trying to check my FPS and stuff, guys. I'm just making sure everything is okay. I wonder what my graphics settings are here on EU.
Game resumed.
Well, that was a fuck up. Yeah, my graphics settings are a bit high. We'll fix that after this game. Oh my god, that was a complete fuck up. God damn it, I'm so sorry to the players. Right, we're going to stop messing around. The Stargate is done for Neeb, and he is starting to set an Oracle out onto the map. So we're going to be seeing it moving over to the left-hand side. A couple of Hellions are going to be moving out here, and just going to be seeing the early opening from Beastyqt, just designed to kind of apply some pressure. A couple of Widow Mines Hellions will run by as well. Get some pressure done, you know, scout a little bit too. Widow Mines here, though, in a little bit of trouble. Has to be careful. There's a lower ground mineral line in a lot of trouble, actually, as this Oracle flies in. Has to be careful with where it goes, though. Picks up three, now four workers, a fifth available on the natural as it just pops out. Since these Widow Mines are going to start dropping now. Overcharges have to go down pretty quick, I think. And actually, Neeb doesn't pay attention. He's going to lose four workers himself already. So while this Oracle's doing an okay job up here, it is still going to be kind of not quite enough because, well, it's going to be good damage, but in the end, it's still going to kind of come down to the fact that Beastie is doing similar damage across the map. There we go. In fact, exactly seven workers killed. So seven workers of seven workers. This Widow Mine's still burrowed over here. Robot facility on the way up. It's going to be the cannon to finish first with the detection, but this Widow Mine should get another shot off unless the overcharge comes in just in time. Nope, not going to happen. As we're going to see the workers taking a hit once again. Three more probes going down, and this medevac to the top right-hand side continuing to move around. Plus one attack, and the resonating glaives continue to come into play. The Phoenix now in production as well. May just be the one or two to get rid of this medivac. As oh my god, Beastyqt picks off another couple workers here. Neeb not having the best of times so far at the start of this game. As we're going to be seeing Neeb pulling on over to the left-hand side with this Oracle, keeping this on the map. Got 8 kills on it so far, and we'll be looking for a few more as the game continues. Obviously, the more he gets out of this, the better value Oracle it is. This Phoenix moving around as well, as Resonating Glaive's just over halfway done, plus one just over halfway done also. And that Stimpak upgrade about to finish up also. Widowmine is in position, so he is continuing to protect this position. I mean, the Oracle picked up 2 more workers, a Marine as well, picks up 1 more worker at the front. Both players really taking a lot of damage then overall. What's the worker kill tab at? 10 to 12. So both of them losing pretty significant numbers. Pretty even numbers too. So for the damage that Beastyqt did, he kind of just evened up the game from the Oracle damage. Now, it was still a lot of damage. Like, Neeb really should have been able to push this away better. Honestly, Beastyqt's initial defense against the Oracle was not really that great. He was caught very off guard. And Neeb should have come out of this with a bit more of an advantage than he ended up coming out of. In fact, did he come out with an advantage at all? Well, I wouldn't really say so, because he allowed those Widow Mines from Beastie to get so much done. Then we've seen this Nexus dropping down at the third base, and the 2 Medivacs, the Widow Mine, and the Marines coming down the south side, continuing to see where they might be going to next, continuing to see what else might be happening over the next few minutes. An Oracle from Neeb moving around as well, looking to see where else he can go. Was this Phoenix just patrolling to the top side? And we're going to be seeing these Marines just stimming forwards in the Widowmine's burrowing. Actually, Widowmine's going to get targeted down. He won't get the Warp Prism. Kills one Adept, but losing 2 Widowmine's probably not worthwhile. And a nice revelation on the Oracle is going to allow Neeb to keep track of these 2 Medivacs and these 3 Marines down to the south side of the map. So Warp Prism is still moving around here and still looking to see what else is going on. Plus 1 armor on the way from Neeb as well, so starting to Chrono Boost that out. That Blink upgrade starting up also, as there's them 2 Medivacs starting to move on towards the top upper right-hand side of the map right here. So these 2 medivacs are going to go towards the upper right, Beastyqt, with quite a lot of units in this. I mean, it's just a double drop, right? But there's not really a lot in position for Neeb. He doesn't have a lot of pylons in great positions immediately. He's got pylons that can keep his opponent away, but not stop the initial drop. As 3 Adepts make it into the main mineral line, 4 more warp in, and Neeb will start to get some economic damage done to the Terran player here, who actually has a pretty decent number of reinforcements coming in pretty soon to help. It's just the number of Adepts that might prove to be a problem, as these medivacs, well, they're looking to see where they can unload, and they will find a place where they can drop and kill off this Phoenix. 12 workers lost across the map, and Adept still here. At the same time, Beastyqt pushes into the third base, which Neeb, well, he pulls probes away from. Does he have enough to defend? 2 Stalkers, 2 Sentries in position? Ah, Beastie, he's going to regret not targeting down that pylon sooner. He is still going to get the Nexus. A couple of force fields will try and help get some more units killed. The Beastie lifts up and gets away, so he's lost 20 workers across the map, but he's killed a third Nexus. If his own third CC halfway done, it'll put him into a nice little position here if he has enough economy to hold on with. Losing 20 workers already is actually quite detrimental. He's down to 27 SCVs against the 55 probes. And I'm just going to be seeing these few Adepts just warping in underneath this warp prism. So a few Adepts warping in beneath this warp prism. Probes are going to continue down towards this bottom right third base, where he will just long distance mine. He has too many workers to saturate two bases with, right? So he may as well long distance mine and get something out of those. But losing the third base is definitely not a great thing to have happen. He's going to see this Oracle coming up to the top left. He's going to be flying in here, going to grab one SCV kill already, looking for a second now as well. It's 2 workers going down instantly. Marines, medivacs, and a few more units continue to come into the right-hand side as well here. And that's Beastyqt. Well, again, he's got the 3 CCs, but the problem is the income he lost. Well, it just means that even killing the third base, Neeb has still been in an income lead. He's still had more economy than the Terran player. So it's been some nice moves by Beastyqt. But has it been enough? He's going to fight in here once again. I kind of like what's happening. He's taking fights which are very, I kind of feel very favorable to him because he just has more units in the right places. I don't feel as though he actually had to lift up and back away there. He probably could have traded out, and losing one of the medivacs is very unfortunate, because now he just loses even more units, which he can't really afford to lose. The game is so close in terms of army size, and he's just behind in upgrades as well. And so Beastie, being so far behind on income for so long, has to make something happen sometime soon, otherwise he's just going to fall further and further behind. As he has a couple of Liberators on the way up, and maybe that will be his, you know, his sort of motivation to begin to, you know, instigate an attack, because he has to push soon. The longer he waits, the tougher it gets, just because Neeb had that advantage earlier. And while things do even up a little bit now, you can see Neeb, as his third base finishes, boom, all of a sudden, on the way back up into that income lead. So he's going to have way more units to work with here. And here we go, Beastie pushing across the map. Those 2 Liberators are about to pop, so The thing about Liberators on Daybreak is there is a lot of choke points and choked up pathways which you can use them effectively on, especially towards this third base. Liberator, it takes two Liberators and you've covered this entire area. And yeah, okay, two Liberators can only put out so much damage at a time, but it's still nice. It's still something to work with. Nice catch on that Observer. Beastyqt going to keep Neeb a little bit blind, so that it's more difficult for him to figure out where exactly he should be sending his units to defend. As you can see, he's already had to split his army in half, going to rely on force fields to buy a little bit of time and to rotate the rest of his army into position when necessary. Those are the Liberators sieging up in the positions we talked about, and Beastie will use those as a position to push forwards from. He's going to start hitting onto the third Nexus here, and just slowly picking away. Nodi hasn't stimmed just yet. There he go, big stim now as he realizes this fight is going to begin. I mean, Neeb's in a very choked up area, whereas Beastyqt has the entire sort of, well, I mean, straight up, Beastyqt has the kind of concave to work with. Widowmines are going to go off and get a huge amount of Stalkers kills as they blink forward to try and get something done here. And Neeb is not going to find the fight, I don't think, to really solidify a win in this game. Not just yet. I mean, he pushes this back a little bit. Liberator is going to push forwards again, and as we see, Levio will have to come forwards and help protect this. And he is going to be starting to push forwards, and he might just get a third base kill right now. Liberator's coming forwards once more. Maybe Beastyqt going a bit too far forwards with these right now. The upgrades from Neeb will be a big factor in this point of the game as well. Being plus two armor upgrades against zero, that will change a lot of this. So we see Stalkers blinking forwards. The Widowmines continue to pick up a lot of the kills here and really being influential in these engagements, as we're going to be seeing Neeb without detection just yet. We'll need that. He will need to get rid of those Widowmines if he wants to continue fighting. Problem now, though, for Beastie. Where's his Sky units? No Liberators left over. Medivacs are gone as well. And all of a sudden, our Terran player is in this situation where he's lost the momentum he had when pushing forwards before. Those upgrades for Neeb really helping out as well. Oh, well, Widowmines will help get rid of an Archon and a Stalker. A little bit of splash damage here and there as well, but still, is it enough? Revelation comes down to Widowmines will go down at the front. Beastie scans, but again, it's the upgrades that are going to be major, major issue for him here as he starts to push on in. I mean, this army for Neeb doesn't look brilliant. It looks very weak, actually. I mean, Archons and Mortals are great and all, but they, you know, they die pretty quick if they're out on their own. But the upgrades will just mean that they won't die as quickly as you might expect them to. Here we go, though. First two Immortals actually quite low on health. He snipes those down and then backs away. It's smart, slow play for now as we see an Archon sacrificing itself to that Widowmine. Next Immortal taking a lot of damage once again. Third Nexus under fire as Beastie still waiting for some air support. And there's the Liberator moving forwards. We'll use the Widowmines to, again, position himself here in this location and just to help him push forwards a little bit more easily and just make it tougher for Neeb if he ever wants to push into this. Here we go. Neeb will pull probes in, which is nice because it will actually soak a few Widowmine shots. A lot of probes go down, but Neeb will be able to push back the army, which has been one of his major issues in the last few moments. There's a few more Marines streaming. Will he get this last Archon? He will. And so Beastyqt pulls away, but is actually going to be leaving while ahead in supply, killing off 20 workers here on the third base. Suddenly it's Beastyqt, he's starting to take that income lead over the next last couple of minutes here. So Beastie starting to make something for himself. Neeb does have the fourth base up down to the south. And while Beastie maybe could have killed that off if he'd seen it, he has seen it. He decided not to, and that's what I was going to say, actually. It may not be such a bad thing that he didn't kill this off here, because I feel as though if he did, he would have given up this position towards the third base. And if he doesn't have that position on the third base, he has bigger issues, because this was the position for him to abuse and to take good fights in with the Widowmine setup and more. So I like the fact that he didn't decide to pull back, target down this expansion instead, and all the rest from that point on. Wolfism continue to be chased by these Marines as the... doesn't quite go down, but actually maybe it will as it pulls over to the right-hand side. If it went to the left, it might have been okay in this dead air area. Going to the right, though, Marines are able to chase it, and Beastyqt shuts it down. Neeb is hurting right now. Is going to be seeing an Archon continuing to morph in here towards the third base. Some probes heading down to the south side. And Beastie really establishing himself a strong position to play forwards from now here in game number one. Again, best of two. So every single map does matter when going into these games. And we talk about kind of the battle for third place in this group. Well, if Beastie was to take a map off Neeb already, that would really solidify his chances of getting through this group, not just maybe in third place, but maybe even in second or higher as well. We're going to see a few Marines stimming forwards. This Oracle is going to get pushed away to the left-hand side. Marines are going to keep on trying to chase it here as we see those Stalkers from Neeb going to be pulling back down towards the bottom right. Plus three upgrades from Neeb as well. I mean, the upgrades have always been something that Neeb's had hugely in his favor here in this game, and that's not going to change right now. He's continuing to pour into those as Beastie is only just finishing up +1/+1. Does he even have an armory, I guess? Is my next question. He does, so he can go into 2-2. In fact, there's the +2 weapon starting already as this Liberator. But siege is just a little bit too late. A second or two earlier, he actually might have gone away to siege up somewhere else once again in this. Oracle still flying around as Marines, Marauders, Widowmines, they just join up together. I mean, Beastie continues to build up into this army, but again, it's a matter of the sooner he fights, the better it is for him. Because the longer he waits, Neeb is going to be in this position where he has those upgrades, right? And it's Beastie's advantage now from the fights earlier. But if Neeb can get those upgrades up and start to harass a little bit, slow Beastie down, who knows where this might go. If this starts to max out, then suddenly Neeb's army supply disadvantage isn't an issue any longer. So I feel the sooner Beastie pushes forwards, the better. Both players on the four bases here, and you can see the difference in the fourth base as well. Neeb taking this bottom right base, which makes a lot of sense. The central base is much easier to push into with Liberators and so on. And so that's a base you won't want to take as the Protoss player until you get to a later stage when you have Tempest and a way to push away those Liberators, which can push so easily through this position, or this position onto that fourth. So taking the bottom right fourth base makes a lot more sense for now. And for the Terran player, it's basically the same the other way around. Very easy for Liberators to hold this position in the center here, while also very quickly rotating to defend a third, whereas up here, you're just so out of the way, and those positional units will just take so long to reposition, re-siege, and all the rest. Just more likely to be caught off guard and out of position. Single Liberators continue to be sent out on the map. He's sending a lot of these out to try and harass here and there. Actually seeing this army of Neeb ready to intercept, and one Widowmine takes a little bit of damage. He will lose that there as Neeb sees the opportunity to come forward, picks off a second one as well, blinks away before any shots go down. Liberator sieging up. Actually, I don't like the fact that he's just leaving these here. I mean, they're just going to die, right? And he's picked off a few of these Stalkers as, well, he will re-engage into this as soon as they blink forwards. Maybe that's the trap that BC was trying to set. Maybe he wanted this to happen. Honestly, I wouldn't put it past him because he actually picks off quite a few Stalkers here, but Neeb does have the force field to push his opponent back. Liberator sieging up once again. This poor Marine at the front is going to get caught off guard. But now BC can maybe come around this top side and come in from a different angle onto this Protoss player army. Disruptor's on the way out, and that's going to start changing a bit of the momentum of the Terran player as well, because it will start to push the Terran back during the fights. I mean that these fights are not necessarily something he can commit into as much as he's been doing so far as well. Stalker's blinking around, picking off one Liberator now. And there's that first Disruptor joining the field. And it is really that kind of next stage attack which has been missing for Neeb for so long. Now my next issue does become actually after this, well, yes, oh my god, he actually loses a Disruptor to the Liberator. Yes, okay, he's got Disruptors, that's the next stage of the tech for him right there. But actually, he's really missing out on the, he's really missing out on the other stage of this, which is going to be the Tempest. You know, how does he start fighting against larger and larger Liberator counts? Well, that's not going to be easy. 2-2 finishing up, by the way, for Beastyqt, so he is just going to be one set of upgrades behind, which is better than it was looking to be before, so that's okay. There's a little bit of a drop down here, going to trade wherever possible. Stalkers will shut down the medevac, though, as it tries to escape. Takes a few shots onto his own Nexus for some target practice as well. But we still just see Widowmines pushing forward. See, I mean, Widowmines are an awkward thing to keep on building now, though, because these Disruptors can kind of just keep on cleaning them up free. Picks off one right there if that Disruptor shot goes for. You just saw a lot of medevacs loading up. They're going to rotate around the top side. Revelation coming down. Neeb probably looks at this and says, well, that's not a lot of bio. Surely I can push into this. And I wouldn't really disagree with him, honestly. I feel as though he is at this point where he probably has enough to push in. But he also has to be thinking, well, where is the rest of the Terran army? And the answer to that is going towards the main base. Three medevacs full of units moving forwards. He has Disruptors continue to pick away. There's the Shade Forge from the Adepts. His Overcharge will begin to pop. He pops all four Overcharges. BC should kite down to the south, but he might be preoccupied with this attack at the front. Adepts have Shaded Forge already. Liberators keep on sieging up. As the bio is starting to work its way through the Adept line, is it going to be enough, though? BC loses this fight very one-sidedly down to the south. And this drop in the main is not really doing too much just yet either. And BC is going to type out G. Neeb will take game number one of this best of two. And a very back and forth game, but Neeb does come out victorious. So we're going to be jumping on in. Let's see what's going to happen to the south side of the map. Our red Protoss player is going to be Neeb. And to the top. He is going to have ended up losing that first game, unfortunately, in the very end. Here's going to be our pink Terran player for my insanity, Beastyqt. Again, what's up, everyone? How are we all doing today? Hope it's been a good day for you all. It's been a pretty relaxed day for me. Took the day to chill a little bit while just doing some general admin work here and there. But it's been enjoyable, to say the least. So hopefully you guys have been feeling the same. Hope you guys have been having a good time. And yeah, just hope everything is good for y'all. And hope you're ready for a lot of these great games. Because this really here is just going to be such a great evening of matches. Last night was really awesome. I think today is only going to be better. So yeah, looking forward to see how things continue on. I mean, already Neeb, Beastyqt is delivering for our first series of the night. And again, we've got players like Innovation, Cyan, Guru, Jim Rising to see games from as well. We'll have 16 maps of StarCraft 2 for you. So this is one down and 15 to go. Lots of StarCraft to go right now. So where did it all go wrong for Beastyqt? It really was just that engagement. His triple medivac drop to the top side, the main base, didn't really do enough. And it hit too late. He took so long to get there with it that it didn't stop Neeb from coming in. And Neeb saw an opportunity to attack where he realized there was a lot of supply missing for Beastyqt. And so he was able to take that opportunity. He took the fight. Beastyqt was just completely outnumbered. So he lost the fight very one-sidedly. And at the same time, he wasn't able to get damage done with that drop either. So it was a big risk from Beastyqt kind of sending three medivacs up there while trying to hold such an aggressive position still with only a couple of liberators and a few widow mines. And again, it just took him so long to get that drop going. Neeb had plenty of time to identify it, figure it out, set up the attack, and then he attacked. And that's where it really did just all go wrong. Just going to be seeing this SCV to the far left side, moving around a bit as well. Two more racks coming down here from Beastyqt in the early stages now, and just going to be this one racks gasless FE. Wow, throwing back to Wings of Liberty or what? This is one of these builds that every now and then does creep back in once again. But it's been one of those builds which... Oh, it is. It's one of those builds which creeps back in every now and then, but it hasn't been around for a while. It doesn't really creep back into the metagame, I guess. It just sort of... It's something that people kind of do a bit. You know, they're like, oh, you know what? I'm going to throw in a Ronrax FE and a big bio play to just try and catch you off guard. But it's never going to be the standard because it's so abusable in so many ways if it becomes predictable. On a map like Varney, actually, you can get away with it. You can do it pretty nicely just because of the fact that you do have those opportunities to kind of deny the scouting early, and so your opponent can't see it as easily as they would be otherwise, because they don't necessarily get towards the natural expansion if they do scout, because the natural is past the main ramp. So it's a little bit of a better map to do something weirder like this on, just because of the lack of scouting that will come in for your opponent. Thank you very much, by the way, AsmodiJM, for the 3-month resub with Twitch Prime. Can we get some STI hearts in the chat for Asmodi? Thank you, Wardy, for the great stream and fantastic commentary. Well, thank you very much for the resub. Appreciate that, and well, welcome back for your quarter year. Enjoy your brand new colored sub badge. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. The resubs are on a roll here already today. Corvus resubbed as well earlier. Shout out to him. And he resubbed during the rebroadcast. I couldn't shout him out live, so appreciate that one as well. Thank you very much, guys. Too much love already. Yes, STI hearts in the chat, please. As we do see Neeb once again with this Stargate-based opening. Going to be heading up towards the top side of the map with this Oracle here. Just going to be heading up towards the top, having a little bit of a look to see what's going on early. And then just having a little bit of a peek around in the early stages. So Oracle just moving around here. A few Marines are nearby trying to have a little bit of a look to see what's going on. I'm just going to be seeing the +1 attack upgrade coming in right now from Beastyqt. You're going to be seeing the Twilight Council and the Forge continue to come up as well, so just setting it up into this game. Just a nice slow start. Second Oracle will come in as well. Obviously, the first has not done a lot. This poor Marine on the low ground, man, like, he is just destined to die. It's just a question of when is the Oracle actually going to activate its Pulsar Beam. Puts it down now as, well, two Oracles, still not enough. I mean, that's one of the advantages of a 1-Rax FE. Lots of Marines ready to go nice and early in the game. Looks as though Beastie will probably not attack with Stim, but more so with Combat Shields. Go with Stim and Combat at the same time with the two Medivacs. And again, just Neeb has to be careful. Make sure he's got enough units in preparation for that attack coming in. Forge and Resonating Glaives continue to Corona Boost away. And again, the two Oracles just going to be sitting overhead above these bushes. This high ground's always been around on Varney, obviously. And do you ever question what these trees actually are? Like, what is that? That looks like such a cool little plant. It sort of looks like an overgrown fruit. What's this? This looks like it could be something like taken very in the wrong way. if you wanted it to. Like, what is that? Some very interesting plants. I wonder if there's ever been anyone who's gone in depth and described the plants and environment on the planets of StarCraft 2. I'm not very much into the lore of StarCraft, I'm not going to lie. But just seeing those there makes me wonder if there is kind of full, like, descriptions of the world. I guess there must be in the books to some extent, right? Maybe it's just something in the editor, some random little plants that really do not have any meaning at all. Who knows? Anyways, it's an important question. We're going to be seeing two medivacs going to start boosting on out. and they are going to go down the left-hand side of the map to try and catch up with the rest of these Marines that are moving down this left-hand side. Oracle already dropped a revelation on them, so he has a good idea as to where these units are, and Neeb will be probably pulling everything into position to get ready to defend this. I imagine his Mothership Core will not be too far away. I'm actually going to send it towards the natural, which is not a bad idea either, because Beastie does have that opportunity to just load up and drop over there. I was going to say, I'm sure he'll be very quick to bring it over if he feels it's needed, though, because he knows about this potential attack down the left side. So these two medevacs over to the right, and we're just going to be seeing still these few Marines from Beastyqt just moving around, looking to see what else is going on. Finds this stasis ward. It's always really nice finding little stasis wards like that. Just gets rid of the what could be such an annoyance otherwise for you. It's nothing worse than trying to take a fight and all of a sudden half your army is stasis. How do you even say that? Stasis warded up and getting completely messed up. And then, you know, then half your army can fight. Half your army's just sat there like, please be around when we pop out of here. Please don't leave us. Sorry for being such a burden. Scan from Beastie. I like how passive he's been, honestly. I mean, he's recognized that, probably this part of the stasis ward has caught some of his units, but also probably because he just feels as though Neeb's had a pretty good read on what's going on, and Neeb has prepared pretty well about this. These two medevacs tried to come in, but they got deflected by an overcharge, and well, now he just sort of sits down there with those. We might see one Phoenix coming out to try and shut those down in the corner. There's two more medevacs loading up. For the most part, though, just not overcommitting when he doesn't need to. Scans into the main, sees the units, so he realizes he can't do much there. Fellow workers going down to this mineral line. He's going to see more units unloading in this natural expansion. Double overcharge will be popped, and he will actually just pick off one pylon and then pull over to the left, where we see these Adeptus and Stalkers starting to fight. At the same time, starts to unload in the main base, and a few of these units will get out here, but the rest of the army already coming into position. Aneeb is just already in too many places for Beastyqt to really keep up with him. Beastyqt is just going to type out GG. Wow. Did he lose much more than what we actually saw here? I don't really feel he did. Yeah, just those three medevacs are units. His work count isn't bad. I think he just felt as though because he actually lost all the medevacs, he doesn't have much of a chance of staying in this. So GG.